Thank you very much, Professor Hari Babu, for your kind introduction, kind invitation to all of those who invited me to come back to what was my first teaching position, university where I taught in India. Thanks particularly to Aloka and her colleagues in the Department of History and the School of Social Sciences for their warmth and hospitality, and thank you all for braving it on what I understand is the first day of classes and coming out to something that I'm not sure what you're expecting. I will say that after the kind of introduction that Aloka Parashar has given, it's probably best to say nothing. I might maintain a reputation of some kind. But since you've come a long way or some way, and since it's required, I'm going to do what I've always done since I began teaching and began research, which is talk to you about things I am working through. I took a decision very early on not to present finished things, because they're finished, at least in the mind of the author, but to present work in progress, present work that I'm grappling with. And that's what I'm going to do. Many of the things I will say are half-baked. Many of them you know as much about, perhaps far more about than I do. They concern political and historical developments in this country at this time, when I happen to live out of the country for a good part of the year. I come back as much as I can. I keep in touch as much as I can. I have, because of internet and so on and so forth, a community that continues to interact and, you know, converse with me, challenge, criticize, respond to things I'm doing. But nonetheless, the location matters. I'm not privy to these debates. I'm not part of these debates in the way in which you are. So I will look forward, that's why I said I was very happy to have some questions and answers, because I look forward very much to your responses to the questions I'm concerning myself with and trying to think through. I've divided what I want to say into three parts, I suppose. One is to try and lay out, and it's very briefly, I want to lay out the questions that we might need to ask, the questions I feel we need to ask about our times and our politics. So the first thing I would like to do is think about nationalism, development, politics in our times, and how we think about them and how we perhaps might think about them as well. And then I want to take up aspects of what we have understood as really quite central parts of the Indian experience, and I think much more widely, third world experience of nationalism and development, and think how those have shifted over time. So I'll do that. Much of that is familiar ground. It's familiar to me, but I suspect it's familiar to you too. I need to rehearse it to some extent to make the point of how different nationalism and development look today, how different they are today from 50 years ago. But what I want to do right at the end, if I have the time, is also think a little bit about the structures, the distribution of population and of power and privilege in our times, which I suspect we know too little about. It's happened quickly, it's happening in front of us. We've continued with the vocabulary and an understanding of earlier times, and it is quite hard to come to grips with the kinds of structures that we are facing. But I would like to raise those as issues, as moments of inquiry that we do need to take on board. So that said, the question I want to ask is how in this day and age can we assess politics and democracy at all? And I ask that not only because governmental authority, decision making and so on has become increasingly remote and secretive. It is happening in state organizations and institutions that we have very little access to. That access to is becoming increasingly difficult in some ways. But also because much of the contemporary debate on these questions, it seems to me, has become a debate about policies, about what are good and bad policies. And I want to ask the somewhat more fundamental question about what is the meaning of politics and of democracy as we articulate it in our times. What is the meaning of politics and of democracy at any time? I think these are the questions that need to be asked. The answers are not self-evident, but they are being treated today very often in the debates as though we already know what we are talking about. So that's part of what part of the impulse to the kinds of thoughts and reflections I'm going to present to you today. A shift from the level of policies, good, bad, indifferent policies, to that of politics, to the question of the distribution of power and privilege in our societies, should lead us, I suspect it would lead us very quickly, to recognize a really quite new ethos that surrounds our political and governmental discourses in the late 20th and early 21st centuries. This ethos is distinctly new. It's markedly of another order. And it is this changed ethos that I want to begin with. And it is this changed ethos that I wanted to point towards when I chose the title for this talk, A Politics of Indifference. Nationalism and development will be the cases, but a politics of indifference is important to me. And I'm not suggesting people are indifferent to politics. I mean, you know, that's too simple. The cynicism even of the voter or the middle class person, the resignation of people, this has been widely commented on. That's not all I'm talking about. I'm using indifference in two different ways. And I use it advisedly. I thought about it. I suggest that there is a politics of indifference which you can see in political callousness, and you can see in bureaucratic obstacles that are presented all of the time, you know, procrastination, process, which will, you know, take forever sometimes. An indifference that might be called apathy, disinterest, callousness, that level of things. And I suggest to you that much modern governmental and political practice is marked by that. We know this perfectly well. It's just that it's something we ought to remind ourselves. It's something that we need to mark as not a position from which people would have spoken in the past, but a position that they're quite willing to adopt now and accept now. My second concern is with an indifference, I might even say with a hostility, to difference, to the very condition of plurality, of very different ways of being, of different ways of thinking, of different worldviews, of different practices of modernity itself. Forget about different practices of life. And I perhaps should say in parentheses that these two look, on the face of it rather, different senses of indifference. The one that is apathetic, that couldn't care too much about what happens to you, and the other that is demanding homogeneity, undifferentiated character. But I suspect that these two actually interact and they reinforce each other in quite significant ways. I won't have the time to spell that out in any way, but we can talk about it, and perhaps many of you will spell it out better than I can. So there are two dimensions to the bureaucratic and political indifference that is the object of my reflections today. The first, I want to put it simply, I'm quoting a colleague of mine from Delhi. The first is a forgetfulness of the body in pain, that the body experiences something, is not of consequences. Policy making and execution, executive action proceed as though what you're affecting are the circumstances, the context. These things will change, but the body somehow continues integral, fully constituted, and surviving through it all. Yeah, affected a little bit more, a little bit less, enabled a little bit more, a little bit less, but in the main, unaffected. In the main, you don't need to deal with it. What is at stake is not human bodies and the marks they bear, the physical signs of thinking, living, working men, women, and children. That's not what's at stake. What's at stake is something more essential, and this is again taken as common sense, eternal and transcendent. Variously, this thing is called the people, the nation, the economy. The nation is at stake. The national interest is at stake. The economy needs to grow. It's that kind. There are no people here. or at least the people here are assumed. So the body in pain is really absent from this discourse to a very large extent. This nation and this economy appear as a rarefied whole. They're already fully constituted, undifferentiated, homogeneous. And this leads to the second sense of the term, indifference. The goal of indifference, Rukmini Bhaya Nair, the literary scholar in Delhi, writes, the goal of indifference is to annihilate desire. We may translate this goal as requiring the containment of variation, individuality, whims, fancies, multiple ways of being. This is my translation. She doesn't spell it out in that way, but I'm suggesting to you. The annihilation of desire is the annihilation of variation, of individuality, of whims, of multiple ways of being. What Nair writes is, how do the systematic sacralized practices of bureaucratic and political indifference inherited from colonialism help contain the complex linguistic and cultural pluralism of the Indian subcontinent? A pluralism that could easily become uncomfortably threatening, even ungovernable. Or more simply, she says, how is difference subjugated by indifference? Okay. So the two dimensions, the body in pain and the wiping out of variety, individuality, whims, I would even say. And I will deal with these sequentially. The one, the matter of pluralism and the matter of development of some large cause in which people don't matter. I'll take these up sequentially, and then if I have the chance following that discussion, I will talk a little bit about the kind of distribution of power and privilege, the structures of power that we confront today, new structures of power, it seems to me, that have emerged in our midst over the last 20 or 30 years, and that we are still having to come to grips with, that we don't have necessarily even a language, adequate analytical language for. So the first suggestion of an indifferent nationalism, that is, a nationalism that refuses difference, okay, refuses plurality. A good place for an exploration of this, a good place to start, might be the Constitution of India, the founding document. And I want to use this because it is a stirring document. It's a worthwhile document, but perhaps we should think about it. Here's the preamble, which you all know. We, the people of India, having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign democratic republic, and to secure to all its citizens justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, do hereby adopt, enact, and give to ourselves this constitution. Okay? November 1949. A significant, I suggest to you, a significant but not commonly remarked flattening has taken place in that statement. We the people of India, already fully constituted, give to ourselves this constitution. I think it would be appropriate to say, you know, you're writing a constitution, you're making an idealistic statement, a statement of future ambitions and so on. It's appropriate, it's necessary to have that kind of flattening. It's inevitable in some ways. How else will you describe the aspirations of the people of India or of India already constituted? Okay, so you know one can take this too far. My criticism can go too far, but I suggest we tarry a moment and consider what a more nuanced, pluralistic, and processual declaration might look like. So I've drafted one. Okay, what benefits might accrue from such a statement? We, the peoples of India, with all our diverse languages, cultures, religions, hierarchies, and practices, social, economic, political, and intellectual, and with all the crisscrossing and fluidity and provisionality of our shared homeland and polity, that this did not happen already, it's happening. Having struggled to end the colonial rule of a distant power and to gain control of our own destiny, do give to ourselves this broad and ambitious framework of rules for continued negotiation, planning, and adjustment of our political, economic, and cultural futures. That's idealistic, but it's more nuanced. And I'm not the first person to do this. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, whom some of you know, more and more people have forgotten Gandhi. That's why I say some of us know him. Okay? I mean, Gandhi is now just a name. 1924, Gandhi was asked, Gandhiji, what is your definition of Swaraj? And he had an extraordinary answer, which not enough people pay attention to. I've referred to this several times in my writing, but I make no apology for referring it to it again. Here's his definition of Swaraj in 1924. Truthful relations between Hindus and Muslims. The removal of untouchability and bread for the masses. This is a Leninist statement. It's an extraordinary statement. Really radical, very powerful. Nothing about the British. Nothing about changing structures of colonialism. Truthful relations between Hindus and Muslims, the removal of untouchability and bread for the masses. But he goes on. That is how I would define Swaraj at the present moment. 1924, at the present moment. Because 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 30 years from now, with our struggles and our aspirations and new things having arrived, the requirements will be different. Swaraj will look different. We should aim for a different Swaraj at that time. There's a remarkable provisionality, humility, and recognition of constant negotiation, of the need for constant conversation in that articulation of what Swaraj is. So Swaraj is not the end of British rule, and Gandhiji said that many, many times. But here's a man who says, that is how I would define Swaraj for the present moment. How many of us can say that? We don't even say it about the books we write. This is the best I can do for the present moment. Well, this is far from even the best I can do for the present moment, but in that it's done in a rushed way. But I think we need to recognize that kind of thing. And we need to make the point that the changing resonance of a concept like Swaraj, right, that applies to almost everything we work with. It applies to nation, economy, you know, whatever, the people. It, not to mention families and individuals and any collectivity. Collectivities come into being under historical circumstances, out of political struggle, and they change. They change partly because they have come into being, right? We need to recognize that. And it is all the more remarkable in a country like India that we forget this, because the first thing that Indian nationalists would say, of course, that India is not like a European nation. This is a multinational nation. We said it repeatedly. This is a multinational nation. Unity in diversity. We have all sorts of things here. So even in the stage of high nationalism, we weren't saying everyone must be the same. Everyone's got to be just like this. This is what Swaraj is. This is what economic development means. This is what the modern citizen is. And so on. So I think we need to remind ourselves of that. And, you know, I was going to quote to you. I'll quote only one. Perhaps I'll quote three people, because the point is made repeatedly. It's made by my professor of English in Allahabad University, whom you will know of, Firak Gorakhpuri, Raghupati Sahai Firak, who said, Sar zameen hind par aqwame alam ke firak, kafile baste gaye hindostan banta gaya. Sar zameen hind par, on this pure land of India, caravans from all across the world kept coming, and India kept being made, kept coming into being. It's an extraordinary vision, but it's a vision that was shared all around. You know, Hindu, Muslim, Sikh, Isai, aapas mein hai, bhai, bhai, you know, all of that is said repeatedly. But Madan Mohan Malviya, who's just been given the Bharat Ratna, right? Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, distinguished Sanskrit scholar, distinguished educationist, distinguished legislator. What does he say? As long ago as 1905, just as Hindustan is the beloved birthplace of the Hindus, so it is of the Muslims too. To establish real affection and brotherly love among these two communities and all the communities of India, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Parsi, he names those four, is the greatest duty before us all. Now, fundamental recognition of establish affection and brotherly love amongst these people is not already given. There are tensions and conflicts of many kinds. And one leader after another says it. I want to suggest that in an age when we are just seeking to flatten even this nation, right, let alone nations that were flattened over the centuries, because some of them were flattened by wiping out Muslims, by wiping out Catholics, by wiping out other kinds of difference. Even in this nation, to this day, leaders continue to celebrate its tolerance, its acceptance, its diversity. So here's Narendra Modi when he was asked in the lead up to the election about the need for reassurance to the religious communities. This is what Narendra Modi said, and again, many of you may have heard it. Hinduism alone, he said, speaks of one truth and many paths. Okay? And he went on to demonstrate this, prove this, by saying, as the official book of Israel, and I'm not sure what that official book is. I don't think anyone knows what that official book is, but that's neither here nor there. The point is the important one. As the official book of Israel notes, India is the only land in which Jews were never persecuted throughout their 2,500-year history. So here's a great claim about how everyone is accepted here. Different ways of being, different paths, different beliefs are all part of our heritage. And of course, this is central to the problematic of Indian nationalism. This is central to the claim of the greatness of Indian civilization and Hindu civilization, right? And yet, from the 1980s on, and I think even more devastatingly today, there's this constant demand on minorities. Are you a Muslim first or an Indian first? Are you a Christian first or an Indian first? Are you a Dalit first or an Indian first? So it's not a question that's ever asked of upper caste or middle caste and upper class Hindus, upper and middle class Hindus, or perhaps one should say Hindu men, because it's primarily Hindu men that's concerned. The fallout in the wake of the election of the current BJP government has been really troubling. It's ominous. And I just want to quote one Muslim bureaucrat's response or articulation of anguish, of concern about what's happening. Hitherto, he writes, this is a somebody who was in the IAS is now a member of an opposition party and a member of parliament from an opposition, small opposition party. Hitherto, the discrimination and the distrust of the Muslim were covert. It was hidden. It was there, but it was hidden. Now the gloves are off. And we all know this. So the BJP Member of Parliament, Sakshi Maharaj, proclaims that madrasas, which you all know something about, across the country are imparting the education of terror and love jihad, completely new term. These things, this education is being imparted to increase the population of Muslims. Terror to increase the population of Muslims. Love jihad, you know, so on. And Sadhvi Jyoti talks about haramzadas and ramzadas in the Delhi election. You know, the level to which we have sunk and are willing to sink to make these arguments is extraordinary. And it seems to me it is a call upon us in the universities and in places of privilege. It is a call upon all of us who are intellectuals or concerned citizens to stop. Just as I said, the body in pain needs attention to, and I'll come to the body in pain in a minute. I think the question of pluralism, the kind of celebration of an Indian heritage that we had, is something we must stop, mark, defend, call for. It is absolutely essential. It is a necessary part of what we worked for. And I want to just quote to you three different statements from nationalists of 50 years ago to again remind us of how the world has changed, how dramatically the world has changed, and we think it's okay. The short answer is it is not okay. It is very important for us to continue to articulate these concerns, these things that are happening in our face all the time. I'm going to quote to you three examples, three very different people from three different religious traditions who spoke in different ways about the nation that was theirs, about the land that was theirs, this land, this nation, okay? The first, unsurprisingly, is Mahatma Gandhi. But what he says here is somewhat unusual for people and somewhat unusual for Hindus. And so we should remind ourselves of this. When I was working on the on my partition book, I read his writings around that time very carefully. And I came across repeated statements in his prayer meetings in the last few months before he died. Repeated statements saying, what will happen to Hindus? What will happen to Hinduism if the Jama Masjid is not there? It's completely counterintuitive. What's he saying? What's Hinduism got to do with the Jama Masjid? What will happen to us? What will happen to our tradition? What will happen to Hinduism if the Jama Masjid is not there? And it's a question we should ask ourselves. Because all he is saying is, That is how I understand Hindus. That is how I understand my tradition. It respects multiple paths, multiple ways of being, multiple paths to God, to salvation. It has never said, this is not acceptable, that is not acceptable, that is not acceptable. What will happen to us, to our country, to my religion, to me, Gandhi, if the Jama Masjid is not there? Right? And I put it to you, that is the kind of question we need to ask ourselves all of the time. That's, as I say, Gandhi's position is well known. This particular articulation I found surprising and remarkably, as with much of Gandhi's thought, remarkably radical, unusual as an articulation, and therefore it stops you and makes you think again. I'll give you two others which are less well known. One comes from the well-known Hindi novel, Adha Gaon, Rahim Masoom Raza's 1966 articulation of his village, which became half a village because of partition, because so many people had to migrate. But it was half a village before that, because in many ways Muslims and Hindus were divided. You know, we are not easily constituted into one community. There are all kinds of fractions, and we've got to live and work and think with them. This is the man who wrote the script for the TV serial Mahabharata. It's the same person, Rahim Masoom Raza. And he was, you know, lauded for that, and people loved the work he'd done, and so on and so forth. So people have certain respect for some things, and then they let go of other things because somehow the person's saying something wrong. So this is what he says, and I'll only give you the translation. In Adha Gaon, he refers to the Jansang, because that was the party, the Hindu right then, not BJP, didn't exist, 1966. The Jansang says that Muslims are outsiders. How can I say they're lying? But I must say that I belong to Ghazipur. This is a district in eastern Uttar Pradesh, from where my father came as well. So Rahim Masoom Raza belongs as much to Ghazipur as my father did. My bonds with Gangoli, the village from which he came, and about which he writes the novel, my bonds with Gangoli are unbreakable. It's not just a village, it's my home. Home. This word exists in every language and dialect. And that is why I repeat my statement, because Gangoli is not just a village, it's my home as well. Because, what a strong word that is. I'm still quoting. This is remarkable writing. I couldn't write it like this. Because, what a strong word this is. And there are thousands of becauses like it. And no sword is sharp enough to cut through the ties of this because. And I give no one the right to say to me, Rahi, you don't belong to Gangoli. And so get out and go, say, to Rai Bareli. Who has the right to tell me, don't live in Ghazipur and Gangoli, go to Rai Bareli? This is my home. So that's the second. These are articulations that were common. This was Indian nationalism. This was the celebration of pluralism that we believed in. The last statement I want to make comes from the Constituent Assembly debates again, and from the Anglo-Indian leader, Frank Anthony, who was asked when India became independent, and he was a member of the Constituent Assembly and the Constitution was being forged. He was asked, you know, Frank Anthony sahab, ab to azad ho gaya desh, now we're an independent nation, we're all Indians, why do you continue to call yourself an Anglo-Indian? Why don't you drop the term Anglo? And he stopped and he said, for good or ill, right or wrong, the word Anglo-Indian, I'm quoting, connotes to me many things which I hold dear. That's my heritage. He went further. I will drop it readily as soon as you drop your label. The day you drop the label of Hindu, the day you forget that you are a Hindu, that day, no, 2 days before that, I will drop the word Anglo by beat of drum if necessary. That day, he said, would be welcomed first and foremost by the minorities of India. For it would mean, of course, this is my gloss on it, for it would mean, of course, that there were no longer any minorities or majorities, at least in religious, racial, or ethnic terms. Now, these are important articulations that we do not hear as much. In part because of fear, in part because we think that they're already there, whatever it may be. I suggest we need to come back to them. But there's another kind of minority status and marginalization, which Frank Anthony didn't address in this particular formulation. This is the minority and margin produced by parallel discourse, that of national development, because national development also produces its minorities and its out of sync people. They're not quite there. These people who are out of sync, who are different, are primitive in some ways. They're archaic. They're not quite modern. Not what they need to be. They need to be Indians, modern Indians. And so I want to talk about that a little bit. Talk about indifferent development, development that doesn't care about the consequences for individuals, about the body in pain. And here, I'm not sure, I was going to read lots of things to you about land acquisition and the needs of rehabilitation and so on, which is very much in the news. There's an ordinance now about it. And the fact is, the very simple propositions about how development needs the acquisition of land for public purposes. That's basically what it is. And there are these poor, usually primitive people, because often it's in the forests that you have mining tracts and you have these other things, land that needs to be acquired. These people who are standing in the way. So how do we get rid of them? That's the general issue. And it's always called the costs of development. And it's also said now, trickle-down economics and various other things, in time they will benefit. In time they will all get better jobs, you know, they'll have better schools. These things are all being set up for them. And that in time is a dangerous word. It's a dangerous phrase. It's like because, but in another direction. In time, what about those who are living now? What about this generation and the next generation and the next generation? How long will this in time be? Because in India, as in the United States, as in many other parts of the world, the deferment of the promises of development and democracy has gone on too long. It happens all of the time. African Americans continue to live, the vast majority of African Americans continue to live in the inner cities, in slums, or the equivalent of slums, in criminalized areas. They are criminalized. They resort to drugs, all sorts of things. The same sort of thing here. And very rarely is there much thought about how many people are being displaced, how they are being displaced, how they are living their lives at this point. So I just want to illustrate that a little bit. The population affected by the uprooting and displacement attendant on India's development is reckoned by many commentators as being between 30 and 50 million in the 40 years between 1951 and 1990 alone. Since then it's greater, but 30 and 50 million already. Worldwide in the 1980s and 90s, about 10 million people annually, 10 million people every year, entered the cycle of forced displacement and relocation in two sectors, dam construction and urban expansion alone. At a conservative estimate then, that a World Bank official reported, about 90 to 100 million people had been uprooted during the decade 1985 to 95, one decade. 90 to 100 million people, this is more than the population of most countries in the world, far more. They are being uprooted all the time. Costs of development, costs of profit making, whose profit making and whose development, these are partial figures, 90 to 100. Out of two sectors, and on those they are partial. So one shudders to think how large that thing may be. The government of India's 1994 draft national policy for rehabilitation accepted that at least 16.5, these are always conservative estimates by governments, but anyway, at least 16.5 million persons had been displaced by various categories of projects in the years up to 1985, and that 75% of them were still awaiting rehabilitation. 1985. This is 40 years after independence. So, or 35, let's say, from 1950 onwards, if you want to take development issues. But 16.5 million people have been displaced. 75% are still awaiting rehabilitation. Tribal peasants, who made up just 8% of India's population, accounted for 40% of the displaced persons. Roughly one-tenth of India's indigenous peoples had thus become refugees in their own land. They live in their land, but they are refugees. And I want to just give you one example of, I had more to say about this policy of displacement and development, right, and its costs. But I won't go through all of that except to reinforce that the ordinance Raj that we have now experienced in the last few days, ordinances being produced, in there, this is only another step in the disempowerment of landowners. Rich landowners, like the University of Hyderabad, who could lose land, but also, and more often, poor, very poor landowners, people with virtually little land. And it is passed off repeatedly as the costs of development. It is automatic. It is something we do not need to sit and think about, except for little fringe groups on the left, right? Nobody is really thinking about this. And I just want to, from Sainath wrote a book in 1996, Everybody Loves a Good Drought. It's a book that, if you haven't read, I recommend strongly that you look at it, read through, and read through parts of it carefully. The detail is important. The general picture is not going to, the general argument will appear familiar to you, but the details are so unfamiliar that it is remarkable. Everybody Loves a Good Drought. The title itself is already provocative. It tells you something. What? That the good drought is money-making for many people. It's like development, it's money-making for many people. So he focuses that large numbers of lower and middle-level functionaries are getting great benefits when a drought happens and aid is provided by national and international agencies and so on. Does that aid reach the people who suffer that drought? Usually not, but anyway. He cites many cases, and I suggest to you that's why, that the detail is very important, in which extremely poor people across the country have been removed from their homes to make way for firing ranges, jet fighter plants, coal mines, power projects, dams, sanctuaries, prawn and shrimp farms, even poultry farms. These are the people who pay the price of development. I only want to give you one example, one village that he cites, and he gives many, many. This is the village of Chikapar in Koraput district in Orissa. And it illustrates my point adequately. All of you could come up with more illustrations if we took the time, because my submission is, unlike the early subaltern studies, even subaltern studies scholars, but others, have stopped taking the time to do this kind of work, to go and investigate what development means on the ground, who it affects and how it affects, how the body lives through this period of pain. So Chikapar, 1968, the land of the village was acquired for an HAL, Hindustan Aeronautics Limited project, to manufacture engines for a MiG jet fighter. We didn't know where to go, Mukta Kadam, a tribal peasant woman, told Sainath. We just went because the Saab Log told us to go. Saab Log is a significant phrase, and it's worth our while just bearing for a moment, tarrying on that phrase. Why does Mukta Kadam talk about her own people, we the people of India, as Saab Log? The Saab Log told us to go. Evicted at short notice, the villagers resettled on other land that they owned, some other part of there, which they named Chikapar again. That village they deserted, they named another area Chikapar. Many received no compensation for their displacement. In 1987, Chikapar residents were evicted once more from the second location, which Sainath calls Chikapar 2. With considerable effort, the villagers established a third Chikapar. This time they were spread out in several little pockets, still largely on their own lands. In the early 1990s, they were served with eviction notices for a third time. The revenue inspector of the area confirmed that a third round of notices, this is when Sainath was doing his research, that a third round of notices had been confirmed. They are encroachers, he said, and must go. Encroachers on their own land, they must go. Encroachers, writes Sainath, on their own land. I just said that. Chikapar, Sainath writes, is being chased by development. And it's a powerful, suggestive. I just want to say, look at the coal mines in Dhanbad. Look at the coal mines everywhere. This ordinance is about coal mines. And you've got Piyush Goyal, and you've got other people saying, you know, the needs of development. We've just got to take the land. We cannot stop. It takes too long. The private sector says it. The government says it. And no one stops to say who is being affected and in how many times over. Okay, evictions are done too slowly, says the manager of one of the coal mining companies in Bath. And it's in this context that I just want to quote to you and ask us to think about a speech that Prime Minister Narendra Modi gave in New York at Madison Gardens, a speech that was attended by tens of thousands of non-resident Indians. I do want to repeat something I said this morning. There are more non-resident Indians in India now than abroad, in that they live exactly the same way. Their world is another world. They have nothing to do with the world we're talking about just now. These non-resident Indians are the greatest supporters of the policies that are being put forward, both by the Congress government from 1991 and by this government. Okay? But here's Narendra Modi speaking to what would be called genuine non-resident Indians in New York. Very rich people looking for that cultural home, you know, that cultural, what shall we say, site that they can belong to. And that shouldn't be too ruffled by differences, by disorganization, by multiple ways of being. It should be one. Ram was born in Ayodhya. This is the truth, and that's the end of it. Right? I mean, it's nonsensical. It is the end of all that we prided ourselves on. But this is the non-resident Indian dream of the land they belong to. This is the non-resident Indian that Narendra Modi is talking to on the 28th of September 2014, a few months ago, at Madison Square Garden in New York. And I will quote you just a little bit from his speech, which reflects on the issues that I've been talking about, development, democracy, and difference. India, he says, is the biggest democracy in the world. We have three powers that nobody else has. And it is our duty to identify these powers, present them to the world, and mobilize them. Democracy is the first one that he gives. This is our biggest strength. And therefore, I think we need to think what democracy means. You know, for Americans, it's very interesting. To hold an election somewhere, especially if there are a few international observers who kind of sanction it, that's democracy. And we're sort of getting into that position. We don't need the international observers, but we seem to think if we have an election, we've got democracy. We need to think a little bit more about this. Democracy, this is our biggest strength. Even the poorest man went out in the heat to hear speeches. This is proof of democracy. Second, demographic dividend. 65% of people less than the age of 35 years. Fantastic. We've got this young population. Also, demand, given our population of 2.5 billion. We want to make development a mass movement, he says. I invite you to come, make in India. If you want human resources and low-cost production, then India is your destination. Bear this in mind, human resources and low-cost production. It's critical. Come and make in India, Modi urges the gathering of rich, nostalgic, non-resident Indians living in America and imagining the India of their dreams, a dream in which not only plurality is wiped out, the poor are also largely disappeared. They don't exist. All that India's leader has to say about the poor in this speech, the rich, is that many of the poorest citizens came out to hear election speeches in the extreme heat of April and May 2014. He does not say anything about the role of money and the propaganda blitz in bringing them out, or even the political choices that they make under, what shall we say, impossible conditions, the constraints under which these are the only political choices available, right? So you come out, you struggle with those things. To the well-to-do, and especially to the well-to-do living in the advanced capitalist West who happen to hail from India, the Prime Minister extends an open invitation. They should come back in spirit and in wealth, if not in person, to the largest democracy in the world where capital investment is sorely needed and labor is cheap. India will welcome them with a red carpet, not red tape, and he said this repeatedly in different speeches. The country will clean up its offices and hotels, the tourist sites along the rivers, and access, you know, if you've been to Ahmedabad recently, you'll see that the Sabarmati Ashram and everything, the Jhugi Jhopris have disappeared. It's cleaned up. It's going to be, what, London or something, they think. There are no people there, right? It's been cleaned up for the NRIs, for capital investment. And the access roads will also be cleaned up. It will keep the poor out of sight. Right, so we've got all this now, and again, part of this, and colleagues of Brinda Karat wrote an article in the Hindu on the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, and how this very unusual act, very unusual and not a very expensive proposition, unusual act in that no other country in the world had actually thought to produce a guarantee for rural unemployed and provide a little 100 days worth of employment or the equivalent in payment. And it enabled thousands, if perhaps hundreds of thousands, of families in the countryside and in the poorer tracts to survive. The last government was already whittling down, reducing those funds. This government is doing it with a vengeance. They can't cut it out altogether. It's too important. It's too populist. You know, it's an important measure in those ways. But they're maintaining the funding at the level of 2011. Right? Costs go up, needs go up. And the way in which that money is distributed is of great importance. But all of this is now being kept down. To contribute anything more, the government says, the planners say, is too costly. We don't have those kinds of funds. To keep up this scheme at any higher level is beyond our means. We can almost hear the whisper, the country can't afford to look after the poor. The poor must fend for themselves. Now that's a very different vision of the world from that, the one that we had in the 1950s. And I'll take 5 minutes to say the last thing, which I would have loved to elaborate, because in some senses it's the part that what I've said so far, you would be entirely justified in saying that's entirely familiar. We all knew that. And all I can urge upon us is that while it is entirely familiar, it is not articulated. It is not said. It is not, we do not pose the challenge. We do not ask the question when these issues arise, and we need to ask that. We may be familiar with it all. I suspect we do not do enough of the work on the ground, that too. So for us who have the privilege and the space to live in the universities, to work and do research in areas that are of concern to us, it is important for us to mark these transitions, the way in which the world has changed. But what I wanted to say in the last part is a little bit more ambitious and a little bit less thought out and less clear. Subaltern Studies, with which I was associated, began 30 years ago, a bit more, with a proposition about a split in the domain of politics in India. And the split in the domain of politics said the state does not envelop everything and politics is not all about the constitution, etc. There is a subaltern domain of politics which functions in very different ways, very important. And for all sorts of reasons, in part because people took that split as too sharp, you know, here's an elite domain, here's a subaltern domain, people have lost sight of that insight. I believe the insight that was presented in positing a split domain of politics in colonial and post-colonial India and other parts of the world, that insight still has force. I suggest that the more I think about it, the more I see, that split domain of politics not only continues, it is exaggerated in many ways, it is more complex, but it is very real. It's very, very much in evidence all of the time. And I would use in a more elaborate version of this talk, and perhaps when I write it up, I'll be able to do this. I would use a version or a term that my colleague in Subaltern Studies, Partho Chatterjee, has used. He's talked about political society. And I would use the idea of political society to posit domains of distribution of population and politics, which we might think about quite seriously. I'm going to use political society very differently from the way in which Partho does, but I do think that he's already taken the step which suggests politics is somewhere else and organized rather differently. That's the point. I suggest, and I'm going to use, shall we say, an imaginary country called Dubai to make my point. It's imaginary only in the sense that while this Dubai actually exists, I fear that this is the face of the future, the world over. Dubai has three distinct populations. It has a population of expatriates. Well, let's start with what should be its most obvious population. It has the Emirati population, locals, natives, who are a small number. They are, in some senses, the smallest section of the population that makes up the inhabitants of Dubai. And they live in very comfortable conditions because of oil. Because the sheikhs have found oil, and because that oil money has made the kingdom very rich, and has allowed a welfare state sort of situation to be developed for the Emirati citizens, people who have been born and grown up here. These people are given housing and welfare. Even if they don't have employment, they're paid, they're given schools and hospitals and so on and so forth. It's a welfare state situation in which nobody starves. It's very important. How long will this last? How long will the oil money last? It's an important question, but nonetheless, for the moment, this imaginary Dubai has this one sector of the population. It's very comfortable, okay? With all the constraints, the women are not allowed out. In Saudi Arabia, it gets worse. They're not allowed to drive, and so on and so forth. But nonetheless, here is a section of the population that owns the land, that owns the oil, that can do what it likes. So what does it do? It welcomes, and it has a huge population of expatriates, European in the main, European and North American in the main, but increasingly Indian and Japanese and Southeast Asian, and you know, the rich from everywhere in the world who are arriving in Dubai because it's tax-free, because they're being invited, come make in Dubai, right? Effectively, come make your profits here. We'll get a bit of the profits, you'll get lots of it, and you can carry on with it. And this very large expatriate community lives in gated communities. They live in different parts of Dubai, separated even from the native inhabitants, even from the Emiratis. They live in their own kind of colonial bungalows, just like colonial times in India or anywhere else. And they live in fancy clubs and, you know, malls and what have you. There's obviously some interaction between these people, but they live there doing extraordinarily well. I call them economic society, economic citizens. They're not interested in politics. They don't vote. They have no rights there, but they don't care, right? It doesn't matter. They can come and go as they please. They don't need it. What they have is these fantastic bungalows and clubs and profit-making abilities, and they, to a large extent, set the terms of the discourse and the vision of what Dubai will be. There's a third section of the population, and you all know it. It may be the largest, but in any case, it's a very large section of the population. This is the laboring people. And the laboring people used to come to a large extent from Pakistan and Bangladesh and South India and different parts of India. They come increasingly from the Philippines, sometimes from Malaysia, from various parts of the world, of the what used to be called the third world. They live eight to a room, 24 to a room, little room, in which they're sharing bunks in three shifts, 8-hour shifts. People are sleeping in these things, no air conditioning in hot Dubai. They are bussed into the territories where they work, they're bussed out again. In the case of Qatar, where the World Cup is to take place, the Nepali workers are dying 15 a day over the last few months. 15 Nepali workers killed every single day. Nobody cares. Development is taking place, the World Cup will take place. I suggest to you, here is a segregated politics. And this formation, I suggest to you, is the sort of formation we already have in existence in much of the world. It has different forms. Obviously, the Emirati population is small. The Indian population is very large by comparison. The expatriate population is small here. The expatriate population in my imaginary Dubai is very large. These things are different. Their fallout will be different. But the structure, I suggest to you, is somewhat similar. If the expatriate population, is an economic society, there's a very large and significant political society, not in Partho sense, but political leaders, political manipulators, facilitators. Somebody called them political, Professor Suri called them political entrepreneurs in conversation with me. I would say, let's call a spade. These are political facilitators. These are people who create the conditions for market to prosper, for the expatriates to live, for profits to be made for the outsider as well as the insider. They occasionally join the gated community. They might be able to cross over. They might become those other kinds of citizens. But there's a very large political society, and its equivalents in India are widespread. We've had 75 years of a functioning democracy and of political development, which has produced this very large section of political facilitators, political leaders, they call themselves, who are doing exactly what the Dubai ruling class is doing for the expatriates. And then you have this very large section of society, which many people would call bare society. shrunk to the levels of survival. I think there's a point there. There's some force in making that suggestion. I will call them civic society or democratic society. And I call them that because this is the only element in India, in Dubai, in the United States, the only element that is looking for collective solidarity, that is looking for community, that is looking for democratic struggles to transform the conditions that we live in. The others are very comfortable with what we have. So the world 75 years ago in India, nationalism and development was about transforming the world. The world today is not about transforming it. It's about making more money on the lines that we already have. Unfortunately, it transforms the world for the worse, for very large numbers of people. There are very few people left with the old dreams, or very large section of people, but constrained, segregated, marked out in another domain of politics. They function in that domain of politics in a way that we do not know enough about, that we need to know a great deal more about. So I call upon all of us to continue our work in this way, where we are concerned about rather more than money making and rather more than letting the market decide what is the rational, appropriate way of being national, developed, or just citizens. Thank you very much.